After a fantastic day yesterday at the FCP Euro Proving Grounds at Lime Rock Park, we're back in the shop, and big thanks to Jamie Orr and to Volkswagen Classic. We have a little extra time to take a closer look at the Golf A59 and really investigate what makes it so special and so different from a standard Volkswagen Golf. So there's a lot to get into here. Obviously, it takes just one look at this car. You know that it's special. You know that it's different. It's familiar, but more aggressive. Probably one of the biggest departures from this or any other Volkswagen that's ever been produced is actually under the hood. So one of the first things we're going to do is take a look at the engine and really discuss what makes it unique and special to this vehicle. So we've got the hood popped on the A59, and the first thing you see is the engine itself. Now, this engine is completely unique and completely different than any other Volkswagen engine that's ever been produced. When SMS was designing the car, they really needed it and wanted it to be at the forefront of rallying and to be competitive. And in order to do that, they couldn't stick with the standard Volkswagen engine design. They really did maximize the design of this engine for horsepower and performance. Your typical Volkswagen engine is a fairly small piston size and a fairly long stroke, which means it's torquey and responsive, but it's not gonna rev really high and it's not gonna make a ton of power up at higher RPMs. So with this engine, it is an 86 millimeter bore by 86 millimeter stroke square design. That means it's gonna be rev very freely. It's gonna make good power up top because you're allowed to put larger valves into it. And it is, of course, turbocharged. First and foremost, when you're looking at it, you see the intake manifold here. This is a dual plenum design. So once the turbocharger has spooled up and sent boost through this intercooler here, it's gonna come down and enter the engine through this plenum. And the idea of that is that it's really gonna equalize the boost pressure inside of it before it goes into the rest of the intake track. Before it actually goes into the engine, you have individual throttle bodies per cylinder. So you can see that there's a throttle actuator cable there, and that actuates all four throttle bodies at the same time. It's gonna make big horsepower up top. It's gonna be super responsive, and it's really ideal for racing use. One of the interesting facts about the A59 and the history of the car is that while this engine was never produced in any great quantity and it never found its way under the hood of any Volkswagen except for this prototype, it did actually go on to be quite successful in motorsport. Later on in the late 90s, the design was sold to a company called Lehmann, which produces racing engines and other engines in Germany. Volkswagen of France ultimately used this engine in a turbocharged form to great success at Le Mans. So a variation of this, making about 475 horsepower, is placed into a Reynard prototype car and raced in the LMP 675 class at the 24 Hours of Le Mans, and actually won its class under the VW of France entry in 2001, 2002, and 2003. So it's kind of a unique little factoid about the A59 project, and maybe consolation perhaps that although it didn't go in rally, at least parts of this car did go on and become successful in some way, shape, or form. Outside of that, looking at this, you can see that heat and airflow management is crucial in the car. All the hood vents that you have that are going to be extracting heat and things from the actual engine bay itself are working to keep air cool there. You also have this inlet track here that actually directs the cooling air over to the turbocharger and wastegate assembly. You can see this massive wastegate assembly here. It looks a lot like the five-cylinder turbos and things that you would see on like the Audi 90 Quattro cars and things. You have your turbocharger here, which I believe is a T3 variant. Fairly responsive, fairly linear, would have definitely been replaced by something bigger on the racing version. One of the cooler little touches about this engine is the valve cover. It has A59 turbo cast into the valve cover there, along with the Volkswagen logo and some part numbers. It's highly unlikely that this car would not have been called A59 in terms of like an actual production vehicle. That's the project name that SMS gave it, but it is a cool little unique feature, and it does indicate that that's what this engine is and that it's for this car. While we have the hood popped, we're also going to take a look at the transmission, some of the other things that we can access here while the car is still on the ground. You have a traditional H-pattern 6-speed transmission. This was designed specifically for this car. It is all-wheel drive, and it is active all-wheel drive. So this is a unique gearbox specifically made just for this one car. It obviously would have gone into production, but it incorporates a lot of improvements over the standard Volkswagen rallying setup that was used on the Rally Golf, which is a passive synchro setup. That one uses a viscous coupling. It is front-wheel drive biased, and although you can get decent performance out of it, it's not really ideal for rallying and not ideal to set the car up to really be a winner. This car used a very advanced, for its time, fully active all-wheel drive system. It has a hydraulic center differential. It's computer-controlled, hydraulically actuated, and allows the differential to send between 25 and 100% of engine torque to just the rear wheels. That alone would have meant that you could fine tune the car for a racing circuit and for rallying, and would have been a huge advantage and something a little bit closer to what a lot of the other competitors would have been using at the time. Outside of that, you have a number of lines down on the front of the transmission. Those are going to all the various coolers. And it's one of the things that really designates this as a racing car. There's coolers for everything. There's coolers for the differential. There's coolers for the engine. There's coolers for the oil. There's coolers for the transmission. All of those things would need to be on this car as a production version, because you need to have those things on the rally car that you're actually going to race. So maybe a little bit extreme for street use, but perfect for racing. Basically what we have here is a dual plenum intake manifold. So you have air that's coming from the turbocharger across through the intercooler that's cooled by the air coming through the grill, enters this first plenum and equalizes pressure before it gets sent across to the actual runners here that are going into the engine. This particular engine also has ITBs, or individual throttle bodies. So you have this single throttle cable control here and this rod that goes across, and each cylinder has its own tiny throttle body that's going to maximize the responsiveness of the engine. It's going to maximize the horsepower, especially at higher RPM. So while I could probably stand here for another hour pointing out and talking about all the unique things that make this engine special, we have a lot more to get to, and one of my personal favorites is the body and the bodywork. So let's do that now. So as soon as you see the A59, you say, wow, that car looks impressive. And honestly, wide bodies sometimes just make everything better. This car is extremely wide compared to a standard Golf 3. Basically wide enough to fit around a 74 millimeter increase in track width compared to a standard Golf. The Motorsport body kit is all carbon Kevlar and grafted into the standard Golf body. So starting at the front, you have this nice aggressive bumper, integrated lip. It has a ton of air inlets and things like that to basically make sure that the airflow is going through to all the places that it needs to get to in terms of air inlet or cooling devices and things like that. Coming down the side, you can see that this line basically follows the factory Golf setup, but it bulges out and it's not quite a full box like an E30 M3 or something like that, but it's close. It still maintains a little bit of a rounded edge, kind of like a standard Golf, before it comes off in this nice angle here. It does have venting on the back of the fender that allows for airflow to escape from the fender, which is one of the aerodynamic components that's designed into the body kit. Before we move any further back, we of course have the hood. This is unmistakable. You have a huge number of cooling vents here. And then lastly, you have these big bump outs on either corner, which are for the raised strut towers, which we will get to a little bit later on when we talk about suspension. So on the side trim here, you have what's essentially a very similar version to the standard trim that's offered on a Golf, but it comes back here and it's integrated into the body kit in a very unique way. It's really difficult to say if this is how it would have actually been produced, because this is clearly a one-off, but it provides just enough breakup and enough detail on the side of the car to kind of continue the purposeful theme that goes throughout. Lastly, you have the rear quarter panel, which is again significantly wider and more aggressive than a standard Golf, and that goes in finally to the rear bumper and the rear hatch. Now at the rear of the car, you can see that this big wide fender on the rear quarter panel goes into this very, very smooth, very unique rear bumper assembly. Up at the top of the rear hatch, you have this little duckbill spoiler. Everything that's kind of been said about the car is this is what would have shipped on the car from Volkswagen to be like bought at a dealership. However, if you look at photos online of the original prototype version of this car, you can see this big, massive sort of dinner table rear wing here with big air inlets on the side. Allegedly, the cars would have come with those components in the boot or the trunk of the car as an item that could be added to the car later on for competition. Those air vents probably would have been used for cooling of either the rear brakes, rear differential, or both. So one last thing before we move on to the interior of the car is I want to talk about the hatch itself. Now, it seems like such a small thing, but when you look at this, you have this center mounted VW rondel. You have this sort of fill panel here with the trim line. This is a completely unique part that was only seen on the Golf A59, and it's really, really, really subtle and very, very simple, but it really changes the way the car looks and perfectly complements the rest of the body kit. So finally, a few quick points on the body of the A59. First and foremost, the original design prototype and this working prototype were both painted the exact same silver color. And there is in fact a VIN number on this car. It is in a standard place on the rain tray of the car. However, it is very, very short and unique, consisting of only 2 letters and 4 digits. So this is certainly not something that you'd be able to register at your local DMV. So now that we've really taken in the exterior of the A59, let's get inside and take a look at the interior. Here we are sitting inside the A59. First and foremost, you sort of just absorb the fact that you're sitting in a car that's as special and unique as this is. And this is something that, like, I never would have dreamed in a million years I would have a chance to do, just like the driving we did yesterday at Lime Rock. So from the driver's standpoint, you have this Momo steering wheel with the custom embossed A59 right where the horn button is. The main layout is still classic Mark III Golf. You know, I've owned a bunch of these cars, and it's exactly like this. This car is probably to blame for the reason I've owned all the Mark III's that I have. You know, from the position outside of the steering wheel, you have your standard shifter marked off as a 6-speed. Your eyes immediately go to the dashboard itself, which if you turn the key, turns on full digital dash display and likely something motorsport derived. I would assume that the production car would have had something similar, or this could be something that only the race cars would have had, or it was just used for the development. We don't really know, but what we do know is it has the ability to display a number of interesting facts about what the car is doing. So this center section here, which is where the radio would usually go, features your fire button. So if you do have some kind of issue, this car does have an onboard fire system, and that would make sure that that got taken care of. This big switch here, however, allows you to change the digital display to put different information up. So you have your oil temperature, you have exhaust temperature, you have differential temperature, you have your engine RPM, voltage, fuel pressures, things like that. Any key information that the engineers would need to know while they're driving the car, developing the car, or perhaps while rallying, if you need to check those facts to make sure you're not overheating your rear differential, you can do that on the fly, and that information is displayed here. The fuel level is displayed in the lower middle of the cluster. Again, it's all digital, and it displays in liters and counts down. There's these three controls here, or these switches, for ABS, rear hatch, and then honestly, I don't know what that last one is. The ABS is defeatable. That would probably have been something they would have utilized for rallying, or perhaps it's just something that's for this particular prototype that does allow you to turn the ABS on and off if necessary. The last little cool feature about the interior that I never knew about until now is that when you open the glove box, there's a number of things in here that are on display. So you have some fuses, you have a relay, you have a central power switch, you have a couple of computer connections, including for diagnostics, presumably for the engine and also for the transmission control, the all-wheel drive control. But you also have this boost knob. You can see it has a little arrow and a little sort of centered point for where it should be set. That's where we've left it. But presumably the development engineers that have been able to drive this car, test this car, and depending on the fuel they were running or what they were trying to figure out, turn that boost up or down for different situations. Of course, once you were actually rallying the car and competing in the car, that kind of in-car adjustable boost was generally not legal at the time. So this would have been something just for this specific car. Normally, on the passenger side in an actual competition car, you would have had a rally computer or something like that for the co-driver to be able to manipulate and make sure that they were logging all the appropriate times on stages. And speaking of which, on the floor here on the passenger side, you can see there is a foot plate for the co-driver. That's pretty traditional so that they have something to rest their feet on while the car is going down the stages and they're not kind of flailing around. Speaking of which, I'm sitting in an amazing Recaro seat. These are supportive, comfortable, and a pretty consistent example of the kind of seats that Volkswagen still puts into some of their more exclusive models, like the GTI Club Sport and certain higher models of the Golf R and things like that. If we move toward the back of the A59 interior, you can see there is a Matter roll bar installed. And this was pretty typical and still legal in Germany to sell a street car that has a roll bar in it. This is typically considered like a club sport modification or a club sport model, and not uncommon for these motorsport derived homologation cars to have things like a roll bar straight off the showroom floor. The rear seats are unique custom. I've certainly never seen anything like them otherwise, and they're basically designed to match these Recaros. So they have the same cloth inlay, the same leather side bolsters and things like that. Before we wrap up on the interior, there's a couple more things I want to show you on the trunk of the car. So we're going to get out, pop the hatch, and take a look at those. Once we have the hatch open, you can see a few things that are different here on the A59 compared to your standard Golf 3. First and foremost, the rear floor is raised significantly in order to make room for all the all-wheel drive systems. The chassis of this car is based on a Synchro, Volkswagen Golf Synchro platform, which normally is an all-wheel drive car, but even with the additional room there, they raised it even further to create more room for that and the suspension, which we'll get to later. First and foremost, you have the fire bottle over here on the left-hand side. This is, of course, not charged right now, but typically that would be charged it up and ready if you're ever to need it for, you know, some sort of incident. And this fire system is integrated into the car so that when or if there was an incident where it's needed, the driver or co-driver would be able to activate the fire system, and it's already plumbed in. So everything is automated in terms of where the spray would go, where the fire would be put out, et cetera, et cetera. Typically there's gonna be fire nozzles in the engine bay or other crucial areas where there's fuels, oils, and things like that. Underneath this cloth cover right here, we see that we have the battery, and with that battery sort of around it is actually a very, very large water tank. This car featured water injection as part of the performance system, and it would use that on a rally stage to help keep the intake charge cool, help improve performance, and help maximize performance. And then the first thing that perhaps your eyes are drawn to is this big leather cover right here. This is actually the spare tire of the car. So go ahead, open that up, and bam, you have a beautiful 5-spoke magnesium Speedline wheel with the original Michelin XGTV tire on it. This probably hasn't been out of the car all that many times, and you'll be very quick to note that this wheel does not match the 4 silver 5-spoke wheels that are on the car. The original design prototype of this car featured these chunky 5-spoke wheels, but in a darker anthracite gray color, which looked really aggressive and really impressive. Speaking of wheels and what they're mounted to, I think it's about time that we get the car up in the air and finally take a look at the suspension and get underneath the A59. Obviously, the wheels on the actual A59 aren't as chunky and motorsport inspired as the Speedline in the trunk. It is still a Speedline wheel, 5-spoke, with the vintage VW Motorsport center cap. So, I mean, even though it may not seem as aggressive, it still has a cool look, and it's, you know, just a nerdy little piece of Volkswagen Motorsport history. Behind the wheel, you got a Brembo caliper. We can see our strut there. Let's go ahead, let's get the wheel off and actually take a look at the suspension. We've got our wheel off, and now we can get a really good look at the suspension, brakes, and actually a little bit more of the engine from where we're standing. First and foremost, we have our brake disc here, Brembo 4-piston caliper with what look like pagged orange brake pads in it. The strut itself, pretty typical Mark III. It's a Bilstein threaded body coilover strut with a more of a standard size spring. I assume this is probably something similar to what the production car would have had. As you can see, there's a lot of thread here. So whether that's to be able to increase the ride height of the car or travel, but it is pretty cool to see that and see how it adjusts. Rather interestingly, there's an old school piece of like crimp printed plastic. I forget what those little machines are called. But basically there's a piece of plastic with a part number for the spring that's been electrical taped into place, probably by somebody back in 1992. The fact that it's still there is pretty awesome. The other thing you start to notice when you look at that is you realize the more you look at the car, this is a working prototype. Although it is a museum piece, it is by no means fully restored or pristine in any way. There's a lot of just little wear and tear and marks and things like that that have happened over the years, probably quite a few of them while the car was in development back in the 90s. Looking at the rest of the part of the suspension, it's actually fairly standard Mark III. The upright obviously is different from standard, but without being able to take measurements and compare things directly, it's difficult to say exactly how different the geometry is on like the control arm and things like that. So these brakes, although a huge upgrade over the standard Mark III single piston sliding caliper, would probably not have been like a motorsport option. It's something that was available, certainly is more than enough to stop the car, but this is more of like a street type caliper. It's probably from off of a Porsche or something very similar to what would be offered on a Porsche. Certainly high performance and certainly a huge upgrade, but not necessarily like a big motorsport piece. It is worth noting most rally cars have fairly small disc brakes because you have to fit small wheels for gravel tires. So that's one thing to note. It's not like a touring car where you have like a big disc, a big massive braking system or anything like that. Just a couple of the cooler points are this hand-cut aluminum piece here that's blocking some of the airflow from the front. You've got a lot of heat shielding that's been safety wired into place on like ABS wheel speed sensors and things like that. And you can see there's a lot of stuff that's, you know, really, as it left probably SMS back in the 90s, I'm sure things have been touched plenty by Volkswagen Motorsport and Volkswagen Classic since then, but it's really a time capsule of the car as it existed. So now that we've got a look at the front, I really want to take a look at the rear because that's where the magic really is. We've got a rear wheel off and wow, this is definitely different than any older Volkswagen that I've ever seen. It's somewhat similar to some of the newer stuff that we see with a multi-link trailing arm design. First and foremost, we've got another big Bilstein strut here, threaded body and adjustable. This setup is sort of similar to a synchro system that you would see on a rally golf or something like that, but everything else that it's attached to is 100% different. You can see adjustable bars for your toe and your camber and everything like that. Looking up into the wheel well area, you actually see there's a decent amount of rubber buildup and things like that. So clearly this car has actually been driven fairly hard in its lifetime. The last little thing that I can see is looking at the way that the body has been extended and these, you know, composite panels are added, you can see little strips of aluminum that have been riveted into place just to kind of take up that gap. So, you know, the factory body has been cut away significantly in order to create all this extra space. And then they put that in there and sort of just finish it off with that. So again, working prototype stuff, it is sealed off, but it's pretty, I don't want to call it rudimentary by any stretch, but it's not the finished product you would see on a street car. And then lastly, before we put it up in the air to take a closer look at the suspension design, we have this little Brembo caliper here in the back, which is pretty standard for a rear Volkswagen caliper. It's nothing out of the ordinary, but even like the modern TCR cars, a lot of these cars don't have a lot of weight in the rear, so they don't need nearly as much brake in the rear as they do in the front. So with that, let's get it up in the air the rest of the way so we can get underneath the car, take a look at what we've really got going on. Here we are underneath the A59 to look a little bit more at this rear suspension. As we can see, the rear subframe here actually bolts into the standard trailing arm areas of a Mark III. So it really is integrated into the normal sort of chassis rails and things like that. Beyond that, it's 100% different. So it's a trailing arm multi-link design. So it's very similar to what you have on a Mark V/6 or Mark VII GTI, or of course the new Mark VIII. You can see you have basically, you have your different camber, toe, and you can even change the caster of the rear suspension based on this adjustable design. We have our rear sway bar here, everything all ties together. And of course, the really, really big component here in the back is this rear differential. So the actual differential split that handles the power split front or rear, that bevel box control unit is at the front of the car. This, everything comes back, and then this differential distributes power left or right. You can see it's a very, very big, substantial unit with a big cast aluminum frame and mounting system. So you can see why they did have to take a little bit more room and space to accommodate for this system. This is very, very beefy, very strong, and significantly more motorsport inspired than anything from the Synchro system. As we move forward and look forward, you can see we've got our exhaust system, which is absolutely massive and is one of the reasons why the car is really probably so quiet. You have some fuel lines and things running down the right side of the car, just like a standard Mark III. You have brake lines here on the left-hand side. One thing I do want to point out is that over here in the corner, we have two adjustable brake bias valves that are installed on the car. Whether that would be something that would make it to production or that's something that was strictly here for testing purposes, we have no idea. But you can see that they're there and it is a cool little touch to see how they're, you know, one of the things that they would play around with when they're building this vehicle. I've got a glimpse of the oil pan. I've got a glimpse of the transmission stuff that's up front from underneath. I'm excited to go talk about that. So let's go take a look. Now that we're back up front and we have a little bit better look of what's going on, although this is factory based in terms of the subframe and control arms, it has been modified pretty substantially from stock. First and foremost, you can look at this control arm. It is stamped with a 1HO part number, which is a standard Mark III part number, but you can see it's been cut, modified, lengthened, and reinforced. Taking a closer look at the actual spindle itself, you can see that there's a pretty significant amount of geometry adjustment to help improve bump steer and everything like that. The subframe itself has been modified, so you can see that there are basically spacers built into it or placed in various positions, probably by about 10 or 15 millimeters to bring everything down a little bit and also sort of fine-tune the geometry on the suspension. Speaking of suspension, one last little part about that is that the strut towers have been raised and reinforced all the way around to help gain ground clearance and increase suspension travel, because of course it was supposed to be a rally car. We now also have a much better view of the engine itself. You can see this oil pan here is pretty large and substantial. It's very, very motorsport, very not factory. It's not a very technical way to say it, but this is very clearly all part of the sort of heart and soul of the car. And one of the things that really does differentiate from anything that's production. You have, of course, your oil filter, oil cooler lines. Oil cooler itself is placed over on the side on the bumper. And you have bolted to the engine, of course, is the 6-speed transmission. The transmission, geometry-wise, is pretty close to a lot of the Volkswagen stuff. You know, even though it is a totally different engine, the basic nuts and bolts of like where they bolt the starter into place and all that is actually pretty similar. By the way, it's absolutely downpouring right now, so if you can hear any noise, it's rain about to come through the roof probably. So lastly on the transmission, all of the connections and lines for the coolers and things like that are all over here on the side, and is just pure motorsport and pure cool, if I'm honest about it. Toward the front, same kind of similar layout as a standard Mark III front subframe piece, but this one is all boxed in, all custom, and it's where the intercooler mounts, it's where the front engine mount is attached, and everything else. At the absolute front of the car, we can see where our coolers are mounted and ducted, and that's all very motorsport, all very cool. But one thing that's a little interesting that I wouldn't have expected is that this bumper is actually made out of fiberglass. Now, some of the replica kits that were made later on for this car, which I hadn't really referenced earlier, but those are carbon Kevlar. This is a fiberglass bumper, and everything I'd ever read about this car, everything I'd ever seen about the car, is that all of those components were a little bit more exotic than fiberglass. Maybe this is a replacement, maybe it was a cheap spare, or because it's development, maybe it wasn't really finalized. It's hard to say. One thing that you probably definitely noticed looking underneath here is that there's a decent amount of wear and tear in places that you wouldn't expect it. For example, there's a decent amount of scrapes and rubs and impact marks on the oil pan of the engine, especially on the bell housing here. And that kind of speaks to the story of the car and what it was and what its purpose was. You know, this was a development mule prototype. It was close to production, nearly ready to be signed off on, but unfortunately it didn't happen. So we really get to sort of include ourselves in a line of probably very talented test drivers, engineers, and motorsport professionals that have had a chance to be part of this car, part of the history of the car, and everything else. So it's really been an honor to do that, and it's been an honor to show you guys what we have going on here with the A59 and tell a little tiny slice of that story. Once again, I have to give big thanks to Jamie Orr and to Volkswagen Classic to allow us to keep this car for a little bit longer so we can provide this look for everybody. One other big shout out to Chris Eyre from England. He's a journalist, motorsport enthusiast, and has specifically researched and written many articles about the A59, and he's actually a crucial link in a lot of the information that I've given to everyone here today. So a big thanks to Chris. I really appreciate talking to you and you helping us out here with some of the information. With that, I hope that you've really enjoyed this look. It's been an absolute pleasure to be able to show this to you. If you enjoyed the video, please hit like, consider subscribing to the channel for other content like this. If you have any questions, comments, thoughts about the A59, about anything, about Volkswagen rallying, just what this car maybe means to you, please feel free to drop those down in the comments. We'd love to hear it. And with that, we'll see you on the next video.